Welcome, it's your host Tony. For today's episode of Actually Existing Socialism, a podcast dedicated to exploring past, present, and future real-world manifestations of socialism, we have on the ever-insightful Dr. Howard Waitzkin to walk us through his landmark study. The name of the study, which Howard co-authored alongside Dr. Shirley Sarcedo in 1986, is Capitalism, Socialism, and the Physical Quality of Life. It takes an empirical approach comparing the quality of life in socialist countries to that of capitalist countries, using a key metric that often gets overlooked when comparisons are made between these two types of political economy, the respective level of development of the compared countries. The Waitzkin-Sarcedo study demonstrates that the agitation, organizing, and revolutionary actions to bring about socialism are not rooted in a pie-in-the-sky idealism or utopianism, but rather in the quantitative and qualitative material benefit it provides to workers and their families. It rebuts with data the rampant false claims regarding the ineffectiveness of socialist political economy. Howard is a seasoned veteran in the world of healthcare who mixed socialist theory with his medical practice. He received his medical degree and PhD from Harvard University, but these are the least of his achievements. He currently works as a professor and is engaged in innovative healthcare policy research, some of which we cover today. Howard is also the author of Rinkening Revolution, which tackles the important question of how we move from capitalism to post-capitalism through actions and inactions that are easy, safe, mundane, unglamorous, and feasible within every person's daily life. He is currently working with the Jar Press in conjunction with Monthly Review to produce educational socialist materials. Our interesting discussion today delves into how his fascinating study came about, its startling and instructive conclusions, the absurdity of popular anti-socialist critiques, the social response to COVID-19, and much, much more. The study itself, documents in relation to it, and info regarding Howard's life are freely accessible in the Patreon posting of this episode at patreon.com/AESthepodcast. This show is 100% listener funded, so if you do wish to contribute as a subscriber, you'll gain access to a variety of bonus episodes and content. If you're unable to contribute, no problem. You can help out by sharing this episode and others with friends, family, and colleagues, and by following us on Twitter at AESthepodcast. But most importantly, you can help out by engaging in local worker struggles, whatever form that may be. Before we get to the discussion with Howard, first, a few words from a show favorite, the magisterial Micheal Parenti.
Communism, ladies and gentlemen, I say it without flinching, communism in Eastern Europe, Russia, China, Mongolia, North Korea, and Cuba brought land reform and human services, a dramatic bettering of the living conditions of hundreds of millions of people on a scale never before or never since witnessed in human history. And that's something to appreciate. Communism transformed desperately poor countries into societies in which everyone had adequate food, shelter, medical care, and education. And some of us who come from poor families who carry around the hidden injuries of class are very impressed, are very, very impressed by these achievements and are not willing to dismiss them as economistic. Say that socialism doesn't work is to overlook the fact that it did work and it worked for hundreds of millions of people.
Thank you so much for joining us today, Howard.
Thanks for inviting me. It's a privilege.
In October 1986, you and your colleague Shirley Sarcedo published Capitalism, Socialism, and the Physical Quality of Life. 36 years later, this text is widely shared on the internet in leftist spaces as a must-read academic study on the material benefits of socialism when compared on equal terms to capitalism. What was the impetus or inspiration for you and Dr. Sarcedo embarking on this study?
I have to give full credit to Shirley about the impetus. This is something that she was working on for many years, actually, before we started our collaboration. Shirley was a dear friend and comrade. We actually met because we were collaborating on the, believe it or not, the Orange County, California Central American Support Committee, which provided material aid and other forms of support for Nicaragua and other of the Central American countries that were at war and basically under pressure and suffering from the U.S. government through the CIA and other ways of intervening, the Contra War and so forth. So Shirley and I met, and she shared with me in the context of our becoming friends some of her work. She had published it previously in a journal called The Insurgent Sociologist, which was at that time actually a very widely read leftist sociology journal. It was published in Oregon at the University of Oregon. It grew out of her coming across this challenge, which is that there were many comparisons drawn unfavorably between socialist and capitalist countries. But she realized that these were done without considering the level of economic development of the countries being compared. So, for instance, the U.S. was often compared to the Soviet Union, and the U.S. had better outcomes in some areas than the Soviet Union. But what wasn't recognized was that the U.S., according to the World Bank, was a high-income country, and the Soviet Union was a middle-income country. So it was a comparison of two countries at different levels of development, and the level of development is the strongest predictor of health, education, and a variety of other outcomes that are grouped together under the physical quality of life index and theory. Basically, that's what happened. It was Shirley's initiative. She's a remarkable person.
I think that that methodology is absolutely genius because it directly counters some of the most absurd anti-communist rhetoric that we've, you know, all heard before, such as if you currently live in a highly developed capitalist country like the United States and don't like capitalism, why don't you then go live in, insert the name of a developing socialist nation? Or as you mentioned, directly comparing living standards between the Soviet Union and the United States. I've seen, for example, people compare the United States with Vietnam, which was, you know, a post-revolutionary socialist nation that, you know, after fighting a century of brutal French colonialism, spent decades fighting a war against the U.S. itself, which ended up obliterating through extensive bombing their already colonially stagnated development. This kind of widely used canard ignores the material realities of these nascent socialist nations and the historical and economic precedents that you mentioned that laid the foundations of those realities. Your study kind of cuts through this framing, which is all too common, and compares the socialist and capitalist countries at the same level of economic development. Could you explain the study's methodologies? What did you use to define socialism and capitalism? How did you break down the level of development? And what is the physical quality of life metric that you developed for this study?
Okay, before I answer that, I just wanted to add one comment to what you just said, which is that although we didn't get into this in the article, the other issue that's extremely important is that the socialist countries, regardless of level of development, and you touched on part of this, were the object of very aggressive intervention by the United States and others of the great capitalist powers from day one. You know, it was the same year that the Russian Revolution occurred that the U.S., the U.K., and various other allies actually invaded the USSR from the north and east. Those types of interventions, either militarily or economically or politically, continued throughout. The so-called triumph of capitalism in the USSR actually was a job that was done, you know, largely in the same way by the CIA and various organizations that intervened economically. So I just wanted to add that. The methods actually were developed by Shirley, so I take no credit for them. I and some colleagues helped refine them a little bit, but it's basically her approach. And it was a very simple approach methodologically. And it used data that came from probably the most conservative source that produces such data, which is the World Bank, you know, which basically is the strongest institutional supporter of global capitalism that exists, except possibly the International Monetary Fund. But, you know, very important pro-capitalist institution. And they produce every year the World Development Report that includes a classification of type of economy and includes the dependent variables that we consider in addition to that, which are health outcomes, educational outcomes, and a number of other outcomes grouped under the physical quality of life index, which is an index that actually the World Bank and collaborators developed. So we were simply taking data and decisions about how to classify countries from the World Bank. They didn't call it socialist or capitalist. They called it market versus non-market, or a similar set of terms. But these corresponded directly to capitalist versus socialist countries, with the exceptions of the recently post-revolutionary countries, most of which were socialist, but hadn't been in existence long enough to see any impacts of the changes in social policy. So we considered that as a separate category. And then there was another group of countries that were countries that basically produced petroleum and so were very wealthy countries, but not in the sense of sharing the wealth with the population. So if we considered those a high-income capitalist country, that would actually skew the results in favor of socialism rather than in favor of capitalism, because it would reduce the physical quality of life outcomes if it were called capitalist. So we treated those countries, in fairness to capitalism, as a separate category. Didn't do comparisons with them. And those issues continue to this day in some of those countries, not all of them, but some of them. So then we put the data in a database, actually replicating Shirley's previous approach, and we then did cross-tabulations. So basically, these were cross-tabulations, which, for instance, in the columns may have had capitalist, socialist, and then the other categories that I just mentioned, and then the rows would have the different levels of economic development, which were also the levels determined by the World Bank. These were their categorizations of the development of the particular country. And then we did some more sophisticated studies, one of which was analysis of variance, which is a way of studying data so you can analyze the variation in a dependent variable according to independent variables like those we've mentioned. And then in addition to that, we performed a multiple regression analysis. On all of those analyses, the results were almost exactly the same, even though the methods of doing the analysis of the data were quite different. And predictably, you'd get somewhat greater differences than we actually found. In, I think, 28 of the 30 comparisons, the health, education, and other physical quality of life indicators were better, statistically significantly better, in the socialist countries and in the capitalist countries at equivalent levels of development.
Could you explain the physical quality of life metric that you used in the study and what that consisted of?
It's actually an indicator that is a combination of other variables. So it's an index. And the formula is in the article. And it was developed initially by the Overseas Development Council and then picked up by other institutions like the World Bank. So it's basically determined by infant mortality rate, life expectancy at birth, and literacy rate.
The data collected and the methodology, as you've just explained, is just fascinating. I strongly suggest that our listeners read the study in full. It's just 6 pages, so it's a brief read, but it's very full of great information. So here are some of the data points that, as mentioned, make up the physical quality of life metric to give you an idea of what that consists of. So understand that while I cite specific income level comparisons, the disparity carries through each level in favor of socialist countries for these examples. In upper middle income capitalist countries, infant mortality per 1,000 babies born was 131. In upper middle income socialist countries, it was 71, which is almost half. In lower middle income capitalist countries, the average literacy rate was 63%, while lower middle income socialist countries had a literacy rate of 87%. That's a 24% difference. In lower income capitalist countries, the life expectancy was 48 years, while in lower-income socialist countries, it was 67 years, about a 20-year gap. To me, this data demonstrates the material benefits of the socialist orientation of one's economy and society. So today in 2022, the country where my parents were born, Nigeria, has a life expectancy of just 54 years. Nigeria is a much beloved country by multinational owners of capital, but has been atrocious for the average citizen. So much so that the life expectancy of a low-income socialist country in 1986 was 13 years higher. Given this data, what were the conclusions of the study, and what do they tell us about the multitude of actually existing socialism nations as they were in the 1980s, and also just socialism in general?
I think you've touched on the main conclusions in the way you summarized it, which was an excellent summary. I could add that for me, I was quite shocked by these results, even though I was very supportive of what was happening in multiple of the socialist countries for various reasons. I actually didn't expect that it would be so clearly shown when the comparisons were made in this way. We didn't do a multi-method study, so we didn't, for instance, have qualitative information about the policies that existed in each country to accomplish this. But in our study of those countries, not that we published, but our personal study, it was clear that essentially all of the socialist countries had very clear, well-worked-out policies, delivering health services, training health professionals, maternal and infant care programs to address infant mortality and child mortality, nutritional programs that also help with those things, very extensive changes in the educational systems to address illiteracy and other problems related to undereducation. So that's what we presume was the mechanism by which these dramatic differences occurred.
It sounds like you were surprised by the data that was collected and the findings, but was there a specific piece of information that you came across that was specifically surprising to you?
The information about nutrition was probably, I would say, the most surprising, because multiple of the countries were actually dealing with major challenges in terms of food accessibility, in terms of weather. They were going through some famine conditions from time to time, and also lacked infrastructure for farming that was in any way comparable to the higher income countries. Most of the farming was still peasant-based agriculture, family or local community-based agriculture. And I had always assumed, based on what I'd read and been taught, that nutrition was an enormous problem in the less developed countries, let's say, including the socialist countries. So it was shocking to me to see what dramatic differences there were in that set of variables in particular.
So from what I gather, the study received favorable coverage in the LA Times when it was published in 1986. The LA Times, of course, is a major news publication in the United States. So what was the response of your colleagues and other media establishments at the time of the study, both the positive and negative?
This was astonishing to me as well, because the response was by far more positive than negative. And, you know, for me, and for Shirley, it was quite a moving, let's say, situation, because there we were in Orange County, which is one of the most conservative counties in the United States. It's in California on the coast, so it has an extremely wealthy population and very right-wing policies in general of its board of supervisors, major healthcare access problems that I was involved in there a lot because of those policies, and major problems with housing and nutrition and all the rest. The poorer population and the minority populations are concentrated in the center part of the county. People could drive on freeways through those areas and not even know what was happening, you know, 10 people in a room and so forth. So there was actually, you know, I was expecting to get really hassled by this in terms of my job at that time was as a professor of internal medicine, and I was chief of the division of general internal medicine and primary care. And I actually was in charge of the primary care training program in internal medicine. It was largely based at a community health center in Anaheim, which was located in this very deprived part of the county. It was a few miles from Disneyland, but you know, you might as well have been in one of the less developed countries for the way people actually had to live there. And that may sound strange, but literally there were some people living in caves and really run-down housing or were homeless. And then amongst colleagues and the general community and the media, there was no significant negative response that we perceived. Now, people may have been thinking this, but we were expecting to have to deal with a lot of antagonistic, partly data-driven objections to what we were saying, not only from local sources, but from national sources, because it was published in the American Journal of Public Health, which is actually an internationally prominent journal in public health. And we only received positive responses, with a couple of exceptions, which the American Journal of Public Health published. There were two letters that raised various technical objections to things like how countries were classified, socialist versus capitalist, or high income versus lower income. There were quibbles about, you know, whether the USSR should really be a middle income country as opposed to a high income country because they had high technology, things like that. But the response to that was always that this isn't our classification. This is the World Bank's classification, you know, based on extensive research on what the economies actually are in those countries. So it was pretty easy to respond to. And the fact that the article is still of interest is also very startling to me, because ultimately it was kind of a scientific publication and a journal with, you know, good distribution, but limited distribution. It was also republished in another widely distributed journal, the International Journal of Health Services, with a slightly different presentation. I'm very grateful for that.
I can confirm that this study is considered kind of a must-read text in online leftist spaces. I believe on YouTube also there are some videos that cover the content of the study and have tens of thousands of views on them. So it definitely is a study that is still widely circulated. Your, I guess, summary of the responses people have to it is surprising, because it was published in 1986, which I believe was the year that reform started in the Soviet Union. And so, yeah, so one, I guess, would have expected a much harsher response to it, but I'm glad that it wasn't so harsh. You kind of covered the common criticisms you received already in terms of the classifications. That was pretty much the main one that I was able to find when I was researching online. Is there a criticism of the study that you think was valid that you received, or was that kind of the main one, the classifications?
That was the main one. In fact, it was the only one. There were no criticisms that we received about how we analyzed the data, because we looked at them through basically every customary approach in quantitative methodology in the social sciences and in public health. I felt critical in the sense that I said before, in that we didn't have observations that would help us explain the mechanisms by which this has been accomplished. But there was actually no way feasibly to do that at the time. So anyway, I have to disappoint you, and then I have very little to say about criticisms, which was very, very surprising to us at the time.
Would you say that you've heard of any common misconceptions about interpreting the findings? Do people sometimes overstate the findings or maybe understate the findings? Have you come across that at all in discussions about the paper?
Occasionally, I've had feedback from comrades, let's say, on the left, that it doesn't address the problems of some of the socialist countries in terms of becoming state socialist or state capitalist countries. So this is a common criticism of the Soviet Union, for instance, how it actually, by preserving the capital system, it actually became problematic in many of the same ways that happen in capitalist countries. The emphasis on productivity, for instance, led to major environmental problems, occupational health problems, and so forth. So we didn't get into that in the article, and it's been pointed out that we should have been more critical of some of the socialist countries than we were. Again, I hesitated at that time to go there. Oh, and I let me say also, and then there was the whole issue of Stalinism. Here's a presentation of the good outcomes in the Soviet Union, but not addressing the problems of Stalinism. That was another critique. I was hesitant to go there, and I still am, because of the constant attack that was underway about all those countries from the beginning of their trajectories as socialist countries. So you had massive destabilization efforts affecting the Soviet Union and the countries in Eastern Europe and the so-called Soviet bloc, and orchestrated military and other, and economic and other destabilization efforts choreographed by the CIA and other intelligence agencies from Britain and elsewhere in Europe in the lower and low middle income countries. What happened, let's say, in Stalinism or in state socialism, there also is a context that needs to be considered. And what happened afterward, of course, was that some of the advances that we reported on deteriorated. A good example was Vietnam, for instance, where it was said and still is said that Vietnam won the military war and then lost the war to the World Bank because, you know, essentially all the socialist countries were confronted with the same problem that Lenin described, which is the problem of socialism in one country, or this, or the problem of trying to advance economically and in terms of human services and education and all the rest, when there wasn't a large enough group of countries to actually collaborate and exchange trade and exchange technical resources and so forth. The ability to maintain a strictly socialist system changed a great deal during the late 70s, the 80s, and 90s because of a number of those factors.
I think that analysis you just provided is incredibly important to understand because the history of socialist countries, particularly in the West, is presented in such a way that all conflicts that occur within socialist countries or any negative impact on the citizens of those countries is the sole result of socialism itself. And meanwhile, the inverse or the opposite isn't true. When capitalism is presented, none of the impacts, the negative impacts on its citizenry and those who live under it attributed to capitalism. It's attributed to instead specific things like, oh, well, it's the climate or a war occurred, which of course gets stripped of any kind of capitalist origins of war.
And, you know, for instance, in the United States, the fundamental characteristics of the United States about what determined its development, major contributions to that development of genocide and slavery, let's say, don't figure into why capitalism is so great. They're usually hidden. And it's only now, you know, many, many, many years later that that's beginning to get recognized with the growing resistance and organizing and criticism around racial capitalism and settler colonialism. That gets into the ideological dynamics of how these scientific facts get packaged, because there are economic characteristics that are presented as facts, let's say competition under capitalism, that aren't facts, they're ideology. For the last 30 years, always had an extra credit assignment in every course I've taught, you know, related to economics and political economy. You can get extra credit if you can find one study that shows that there's a positive impact of capitalist competition on any health outcome. And then beyond that, if you can find any study that shows any benefit on any economic outcome. And no one's been able to find a study that shows either thing after I've looked at it, looked for them, and many other people have. So it's really a kind of sad comment on how easy it is to believe teachings that actually aren't scientifically reached.
Exactly. And one of the goals of this podcast is to work through, or I guess maybe to expose some of these falsehoods of how socialism is presented, how the history of socialism is presented, how the present day manifestations and current manifestations globally of socialism is presented. Why do you think the study you and Saraceto put together, comparing capitalism, socialism, nations at the same level of development, or in other words, on equal terms, was and is still relatively rare? So this is the only study that I've seen, at least to this level, do this. I believe I've seen maybe comparisons of healthcare between capitalist and socialist nations, but I've never seen another study like the one you've done. Why do you think that is?
Right. So there are various political economic variables that continue to be studied. For instance, the role of government in organizing national programs of health services. And there was actually a systematic review of those that came out in the American Journal of Public Health a couple of years ago, you know, that basically showed that countries that have strong political and economic policies favoring the delivery of services as far as possible in a unified health system that isn't organized according to different types of services for different people, that those countries actually had much better outcomes. But the reason that you haven't seen any studies like it, and the reason that I haven't tried to replicate it, unfortunately, very unfortunately, Shirley passed away shortly after the article was published. I've tried to figure out how to do it again. What happened is that the World Bank, shortly after the study was published, changed the way that they presented these data. So for instance, the classification according to market versus non-market kind of changed, and the whole thing became much more oriented to development level than political economic system. And so it's really hard to get data as systematically and extensively available now from the World Bank or any other source than it was at that time. And the other reason was because, you know, some of the socialist countries have arrived at forms of political economic organization that can't be neatly classified in the same way. Let's take China, for instance, or Vietnam, for that matter. So these are countries that have substantial parts of the economy that are in the private sector and run by markets, and they're essentially capitalist sectors of the economy, plus huge public state sectors that are actually bigger than the private sectors. And the leadership of those countries try to use the income generated and the wealth generated by the capitalist sectors of the economy to basically redistribute wealth. And for example, in China, under this policy, there's been the most massive change in the distribution of wealth in the history of the world, essentially the elimination of extreme poverty from China in a period of 20 years. And I'm not expressing my enthusiastic support for that approach at all. Countries with a combination of a capitalist sector within an officially socialist regime. Now, the interesting thing historically about that is that this was actually part of Lenin's plan. So Lenin is often misconstrued as saying that, you know, through the dictatorship of the proletariat, we would get a cadre of leaders that would then have power. And he actually did say something like that, but it was intended as a transition. And after the transition in the communist state, as opposed to the socialist, there was plenty of room for markets, decentralized markets in particular, community-based markets, and an effort to decentralize the command structure of the economy. So this was a Leninist idea, and actually its history to me has been very interesting. I'm not an expert on it. I did discover at one time that Che Guevara's economic writings, which have yet to be published in English, they're basically called the economic manuscripts, and they consist of a very strong critique of Stalinism in terms of economic policy. And it focuses on exactly this situation of over-centralization, too much command structure within the national economy, lack of adequate decentralization, and a lack of freedom of people at the lower level to carry on their own market-based activities, which is not to say they're capitalist activities, just because they're market-based. In other words, they don't involve the extraction of surplus value from workers. In other words, capitalists sit around, and no matter how nice they are, they pay workers basically a subsistence wage, and they get value way above that. And that's the surplus value that's the inherent exploitation that characterizes capitalism, regardless of how well-motivated a capitalist is. You can't have capitalism without accumulation, and you can't have capitalism without surplus value. And so these socialist markets do not have surplus value, at least they're not supposed to, and actually most of them set up have really struggled not to when they've been set up. And I can refer to Cuba, for example, as one aspect of that in recent years. It's not perfect. The changes that have happened in terms of the introduction of market sectors within socialist economies like China and Vietnam, or the transitions that are happening as we speak in countries like Venezuela, let's say, which is an official attempt to transition beyond the capitalist state and to transition to governance done in a communal structure that's much more local and less under a central command structure. And, you know, because Venezuela has been under severe attack for years now, it's not been possible to implement that as much as Hugo Chavez and actually Nicolas Maduro intended. But there's still a very strong communal structure in many parts of Venezuela. It's thought that that's the main reason there hasn't been an invasion of Venezuela. These issues of how markets figure in socialist systems is very pertinent to the questions that we were asking and how we might do a study reconsidering this. I know of no database like the World Bank, let's say, that gets into these distinctions. Is it socialist when there are capitalist markets within socialism? Many people say, well, China's a capitalist country now. But when you look at the economic activities and how divided into different sectors, it's a relatively small sector of the overall Chinese economy that's capitalist, and a huge public sector. And it's the public sector that actually has taken on the massive redistribution of wealth and the nutrition programs and the health programs and all the rest, none of which I think is perfect, but you know, there have been some remarkable achievements, especially in terms of the eradication of poverty.
And this is a great segue to our final question, which is your thoughts or even knowledge, I guess, in regards to the fiscal quality of life in socialist countries today, the few that are remaining, say, for example, Cuba, Laos, North Korea, Vietnam, compared to capitalist nations at the same level of development now in 2022. Would you hypothesize that the results of the study would look like in 2022? I guess given what you've already just discussed, there is more of an interlap in terms of socialist market economies existing, unlike they did, say, for example, during the 1950s or 60s.
Right. The problem is that a number of the socialist countries that, or the recently post-revolutionary countries that we considered in that article, have not officially become capitalist, have remained socialist officially, but have decided as a matter of national policy to integrate in various ways to the global capitalist system. And again, this, in my opinion, all has to do with you can't have socialism in one country, problem that goes back to the beginning of the Russian Revolution. And there are compromises that they've all made. And you know, to my knowledge, they've all been made consciously and purposefully, not to benefit capitalism per se, but to have a mixed effect. You know, for instance, China allows a pretty large sector of ultra-rich people there. And there are actually reforms that are being proposed to take some of that wealth away. Now, but the fact is they depend on their rich capitalists to generate some of the wealth that then gets redistributed. So how to classify becomes a much more subtle process. I can tell you that it may be possible to do something that would involve a more questionable source for the data, you know, like me, as opposed to World Bank economists, that would actually try to figure out these distinctions within socialist countries based on market involvement or not. I can tell you some observations. I'm actually writing two items currently. One is about the transition from capitalism to post-capitalism at the current moment. And the other is about the COVID-19 pandemic. And this issue about the differences between capitalists and other types of political economic systems comes up in both settings. One of the amazing things to me that I discovered by being based in Korea to a certain extent, because my wife Mira is a doctor here, and so we've tried to bridge our residencies, which has become harder and harder because of the pandemic. But one of the things I did, I had a Fulbright actually at Seoul National University 3 years ago at the School of Public Health, which is the National School of Public Health. And my courses were all about health policy in one form or another, comparative international health policy. So I decided to put North Korea on the list of things to study. And this actually was the first time this ever had been done, as it turned out, at the National School of Public Health in South Korea.
Wow.
And what we found was really amazing, which was that there's all these publications about this that are joint efforts between the North Korean Ministry of Health and the World Health Organization. including a number of comparisons that were similar to those that Shirley and I did. For instance, there's a very interesting paper that was actually published, I think, in the Journal of the Korean Medical Association in South Korea, eventually, that showed that compared these physical quality of life outcomes, literacy, health outcomes, educational outcomes, and so forth, amongst the East and Southeast Asian countries. And what they found was that North Korea is not as well off as South Korea, because South Korea is now at a higher level of economic development, but equal or better than any other country in East or Southeast Asia, which is pretty different from the images that I learned in school and through the media and so forth. You know, that North Korea is a land of suffering and it's a dictatorship. The reality is that the joint publication of WHO and North Korea on the Korean health system and Korean medical problems is very straightforward about a lot of problems in North Korea. Like there's a whole section on this problem of smoking, especially among men, and the fact that it's become a major public health problem and has led to a major recent public health initiative. That's tough to do because the government gets a lot of revenue from the state-owned tobacco industry. And then there are reports about problems with tuberculosis, with maternal and infant care, with marginalized and rural communities, and on and on. So this is not Kim Jong-un getting up and spouting propaganda about how wonderful things are. On the contrary, it's very specific, detailed information about the successes and failures of health in health and other spheres in North Korea. North Korea actually won one of the regional WHO awards about 4 years ago for eliminating measles. Now, there's an accomplishment that hasn't been accomplished in the States, Canada, or most other high-income countries, to my knowledge, but it's been accomplished and verified in North Korea. Now, what I'm saying to you was absolutely astonishing to me. I was not expecting to find any of this. And so, you know, what happens when you actually take the time and energy to look into it, you know, it's pretty amazing what you can find in terms of who has better outcomes. Now, I'm trying to, with a couple of colleagues, trying to do something similar in terms of how the pandemic has been handled and what the outcomes there have been. So we have a number of the so-called ex-socialist countries that are actually officially socialist countries with capitalist sectors of the economy, like China, Vietnam, and so forth. And you have regions like Kerala state in India, which is basically a left-wing socialist-run state. And then you have Cuba, and then you have Venezuela, Nicaragua, and so forth. And when you look at what actually has happened in those countries, all of those countries have had very extensive community-based mobilizations of people basically going door-to-door or similar on cell phones or whatever, trying to figure out whether people, first of all, have been tested. We try to make sure people are tested. If they're positive, they arrange quarantines and make sure people have enough food, supplies, and so forth for that. They try to figure out the relationship between the person and whatever economic activities are going on. They either provide financial supplements if they're not in the state sector, or their state sector jobs continue, even though they're quarantined or sick. So these are policies that, you know, are seen to some extent in some of the European so-called mixed systems, seen in New Zealand to some extent, to a lesser extent in Australia. But these are fundamental characteristics of these particular countries. And in terms of the official data, all of those countries have done extremely well in terms of numbers of cases, deaths, and other indicators in the COVID epidemic. There are certain capitalist countries that make no bones about being capitalist, like South Korea, that also have been done relatively well, although South Korea currently is in a very bad situation because it pretty much gave up on its epidemiological accomplishments during the Omicron phase. So it's actually the worst phase of the whole pandemic that's going on now here. And more, you know, the most deaths in a day for the whole pandemic happened 2 days ago here. But in general, the numbers of deaths and cases are a fraction of what they've been in the vast majority of other capitalist countries. And the reason that's happened is also by community-based mobilization in South Korea. It's done because there's a well-organized public health structure in every county, and the whole pandemic has been managed at the county level here. Testing, diagnosis, interventions, home visits. So it's not just the central government in the officially socialist countries now, or the central government in capitalist countries like Korea that are actually accomplishing the much better processes and outcomes in those countries. It actually has to do with community-based mobilization, which is part of the historical socialist project. For the capitalist countries, it's not a historical tradition. The historical tradition is generally to let people fend for themselves. The welfare states in some of the capitalist countries like Europe are part of the capitalist states. And during periods of economic crisis under capitalism, those welfare states have gotten cut back and privatized. So the previously excellent examples, like the British National Health Service and the Dutch Health Service and so on and so forth, have very much deteriorated in both process and outcome, as they've been subject to changes in the capitalist welfare state under neoliberalism. So those are some brief answers to what it might look like now. It's, you know, to summarize, it's hard to get conservative data that actually categorize the countries in similar ways as the World Bank used to categorize. And it's also more complicated to really understand the nature of the political economic systems in the context of development and underdevelopment.
So that was a great and very thorough answer, Howard. In regards to the study that you're currently undergoing, I would love to have you back on to discuss that in depth in regards to the community-based mobilization within capitalist countries, which reflects more of a socialist tradition that has been ongoing for, I guess, over a century now.
Part of this effort about COVID has to do with upstream causes. And it's pretty much accepted now that the cause of this pandemic and every other zoonotic epidemic or pandemic in the last 30 or 40 years, AIDS, multiple flu epidemics, Zika, et cetera, the swine flu epidemic, et cetera, all reflect destruction of habitat, deforestation, and the expansion of industrial agriculture. So what I can say is, in my studies of this, that not one of any of the countries have actually tackled that problem in a meaningful way. For instance, North Korea has actually an active reforestation program going on, but it's not linked to pandemic prevention as it should be. And so that's a major problem because the conditions for recurrence of a pandemic are getting actually worse rather than better. So part of this work about the pandemic actually focuses on the upstream causes and also the problem of blaming economic collapse on the pandemic when the collapse was actually in process and predicted months and months before the pandemic.
Thank you so much, Howard, for going through one of your landmark studies. And I guess we can look forward to your current study in regards to COVID-19. Thank you so much for being on the show, Howard, and please take care.
Thank you, Tony.
To learn more about the study and further information regarding Howard's work and what we covered today, you can check out the freely accessible Patreon posting of this episode at patreon.com/AES the podcast.